Good morning. Thank you for joining us for today's episode in our Facebook Live series. I'm your host, Betsy Anthony, and I'm a historian at the museum's Mandel Center for Advanced Holocaust Studies. 80 years ago today, the Germans and their collaborators carried out one of the largest mass shootings of the Holocaust, the massacre in the Ravine in Babi Yar at the northwest outskirts of Ukraine's capital city of Kiev. Similar killings played out across Eastern Europe as Jewish men, women, and children were gunned down in broad daylight and left to die in mass graves. Some of what we know comes from witnesses and survivors, like a young woman who climbed out of a deep ravine after almost being shot and buried alive. We'll share her powerful recollections about a moment when all humanity seemed to be gone. I'm pleased to welcome a dear friend and colleague, Dr. Wendy Lauer, the author of The Ravine, A Family, A Photograph, A Holocaust Massacre Revealed. Wendy will share her insights about the massacres the Nazis carried out in the former Soviet Union, often with local cooperation. During today's show, please send us your questions for Wendy in the comments section. Wendy, welcome. And thank you so much for joining us. The history we're sharing today isn't the Holocaust narrative most people are used to. There are no cattle cars, no barbed wire fences, no shaved heads, no striped uniforms. These killings, the killings that began in 1941, are sometimes called the Holocaust by bullets. What does that mean?
The Holocaust by bullets is a lesser known aspect of Holocaust history that began with the Nazi attack on the Soviet Union in the summer of 1941, which was called Operation Barbarossa. At this point, Hitler and his allies, and here we see some footage, propaganda footage of the German invasion of the Soviet Union. He was determined to take over what was the Soviet Union and turn that into a German-only, Aryan-only colony. It was his racial empire that he was seeking to create. And the first step in creating that, besides actually militarily conquering that territory, was to what he called kind of cleanse the entire Eastern Europe of its Jews. There could be no German-only empire in these territories if Jews resided there. They were deemed the number one enemy of the Germans. Once the Germans arrived in these territories, the Einsatzgruppen, these are German motorized security forces, killing squads actually, that went into the territory and immediately started rounding up male Jews, deemed the first kind of threat, and as well Soviet POWs who were captured. This is a picture showing a mass shooting committed by these so-called security forces against Jewish men. It's a military style execution. They're forced into this trench. They're rounded up, brought out from their communities and brought in there. And you can see that they're killing them. Within a matter of weeks, this expanded to Jewish women and children, and entire communities were targeted. Hitler told his Croatian ally in the summer of 1941, not one Jewish family is to remain on the continent of Europe. A lot of this work was done with the help of local collaborators. So it's important when we think about the Holocaust by bullets to consider that this was done in broad daylight. This was done that the perpetrators went to the victims. They were not deported to these killing centers. They were not registered. We have very little traces of documentation because they were so quickly rounded up within days of the Germans' arrival and executed in this way.
Thank you. I just want to take a moment also to thank some of our audience members for joining us from Texas, Tennessee, Dartmouth, Massachusetts, Minnesota, Tarrytown, New York, and international visitors from Slovakia and Israel, Montreal, the Netherlands. It's really great and important that you could join us today. Wendy, we know that almost 34,000 Jewish men, women, and children were gunned down at the Babi Yar Ravine in just 2 days. Let's examine the experience of a Jewish survivor of that massacre to get a better understanding of how this mass shooting was carried out. Tell us about Dina Pronicheva.
Dina is one of the very few survivors. The Holocaust by bullets, as I just described it, was such a sudden assault on the communities. Really, they had such little time to even decide what to do. And even in this case of what happened in Kiev, the largest Jewish urban population in Ukraine, and of course the Germans, when they came in, realized that they had a large population in their mind to kind of contend with. And so within days of arriving in Kiev, they started to organize this mass murder. They had already tested out various methods on their march towards Kiev across Ukraine and towns like Berdychev. And this was the heart of Jewish life in the Russian Empire, in the Pale of Settlement. There were very high population densities. And so shortly after they arrived in Kiev, a combination of military and SS and police started to organize this shooting, putting up posters announcing that the Jews should gather at a particular spot at the outskirts of town. And this outskirts of town was this ravine called Babi Yar. It was a very deep geological structure. It was almost 50 meters deep at the outskirts. And Dina was one of the Jewish families that was called up. She was born in 1911. She married a Russian man. Here they are in this photograph, the two of them, in the 1930s. They had two small children. She was in September 1941, she was 30 years old, and she had a one-year-old and a three-year-old. She managed to place those children in a children's home, and they survived the war. But she had to appear with her Jewish family, with her parents and her sister, actually, at this site when they were called to gather. And there were rumors that perhaps at the gathering point, they might be deported to a labor assignment. The gathering point was near a freight railway station. They were going to be handled like human cargo. And here's the actual announcement. And it appeared in Russian, Ukrainian, and German. And the largest text that you see here in Russian is very clear that any Jews who do not follow this order and are found elsewhere will be shot. And the local community was also warned that if they sheltered any Jews, that they would be punished as well.
And so what happened? What happened when Dina and her family or her relatives arrived there at Babi Yar?
Well, according to her testimony, which is extremely rare because she's the only known person to have survived by jumping into the ravine without being shot. So she was brought to this gathering spot. Thousands of Jews are being gathered and marched out there. She describes the screaming children, the chaos, the attempt to kind of separate women and children and family members. And they're being forced to undress, and there are piles of clothes, and there are bullets firing. The women and some of the girls are being brought to the side. And sexually assaulted. They're being beaten at the scene. It's a bloody scene, a loud, horrific scene. And they knew that what awaited them, because when they arrived there, one of the memories she shared was that they burned their IDs, and those documents were so important for their survival. And so they realized that they weren't going to be led anywhere else, that their fate was going to be at the bottom of this ravine. They were forced through a gauntlet of the killers' beatings to the actual precipice of the ravine, or forced down into the ravine and shot what they called the sardine method execution style. They were forced to lie down, face down, or they were shot at the top of the ravine and then pushed into the ravine in that way. And this is how the Nazis utilized this, what was a geological wonder at the edge of town, a natural fortification for Kiev. They used that as a way to carry out these mass executions. Here you can see the magnitude of the massacre just in the piles of the Jewish belongings, what they were forced to leave behind, their precious valuables and local auxiliaries as well as German officials are kind of sorting through these materials. They're going to recycle them. They're going to repurpose them. They're going to give them to Germans, regular German civilians, and they're also going to give them to local Ukrainians who assisted as collaborators.
Wendy, as we know, Dina testified about her experience in 1946 at the first trial of war criminals in Kiev. That trial resulted in the convictions of 15 German and Austrian members of police organizations. We have a clip from Dina's testimony, so we can take a look and hear her describe some of what she endured.
They lined us up on a ledge, which was so small that we couldn't get much of a footing on it. They began shooting us. I shut my eyes, clenched my fists, tensed all my muscles, and took a plunge down before the bullets hit me. It seemed I was flying forever, but I landed safely on the bodies. After a while, when the shooting stopped, I heard the Germans climbing into the ravine. They started finishing off all those who were not dead yet. I was lying so still, without stirring, terrified of giving myself away. I felt I was done for.
That's chilling, watching and hearing Dina describe her experiences before that packed courtroom. How did she manage to escape the ravine and survive?
As she mentioned in her testimony, which is, again, it's really, she's incredible bravery to come out at that moment and in that scene facing the German killers and provide that searing testimony, which she continued to do until she died in 1977. She even traveled to Germany in another case, another trial, and testified to West Germany. So Dina crawled out of that ravine in the darkness. There were others who were able to crawl out. They were rounded up and put on a kind of in a cart and some sort of moving vehicle to be brought to another location where they were going to be shot. And she jumped out, and that was the beginning of her odyssey, of her harrowing years. She going in hiding. She was able to acquire some false papers, and she was kind of posing as a non-Jew, but she did miraculously survive. And this is what it took. I mean, with the Holocaust by bullets, you are out in the open and dependent on the local population to survive, and moving from place to place in all of the weather and all of the conditions. So to first survive the shooting was absolutely astounding. But then years of being kind of on the run and in hiding, and often in very hostile environments, and being denounced by local Ukrainians and Russians and Belarusians as you're just trying to survive.
Yeah, and I mean, she was obviously a very brave woman, and with some luck, I guess these miracles could happen.
Her family, her parents and her sibling did not survive the mass shooting. And apparently she went back to Babi Yar every year to pay her respects to them.
We have a comment from one of our viewers, Marina. She says, thank you for remembering. My grandmother was part of the recovery unit, hiding by day and digging out survivors by night. She and my uncle, who was two at the time, survived thanks to a righteous Gentile. We are Jews. Thank you for sharing that, Marina. Wendy, what happened at Babi Yar was horrific, but we also know that it wasn't unusual. The Germans carved a bloody path through the Soviet Union. You came across a photo, actually the photo we saw at the opening of our program today. It captures a moment from another massacre in action. Tell us how you came upon this photo and the information it reveals.
Yes, this is a very disturbing photo. So I just want to acknowledge that for all of our viewers who are seeing this for the first time, kind of walk you through what we're seeing. It is a very vivid depiction of of this phenomenon of the Holocaust by bullets. We're talking about close to half the population of Jews who were murdered during the Holocaust in these open air mass shootings and kind of ghetto liquidations outside the gassing centers, the killing centers. So this is mostly in the territory of the former Soviet Union. This photograph, which powerfully shows us the act of murder, the kind of penultimate horror of the Holocaust, of the violence, is the killing of a Jewish family in the center of this image. We have German officials. These are actually customs guards. I looked into their uniforms and their markings. They're not ordinary kind of police. These are officials who are supposed to be checking packages at the local train station. And they were recruited on the spot. They volunteered. This is an all-volunteer killing squad. Those are Ukrainian militia wearing red army coats with these armbands. That's their uniform. And we have on the ground what looks like a Jewish victim, a male victim's, his shoes, his coat. He perhaps was killed right before the women and children at the center. There's some papers or things kind of strewn at the edge of the precipice. Again, the Germans are using a ravine. They're using this large pit here in the landscape of Ukraine. This is Mirapol. I was told a bit of information about it to start with. October 13th, 1941, the family was killed in Mirapol, Ukraine, about 100 miles west of Kiev. It's after Babi Yar, but a similar kind of action, but on a much smaller scale. And here we have this child and the mother, or the aunt actually, in that polka dot dress with the Mary Jane shoes, bending over with the smoke because of the firing. And on her lap, if you look closely, you might see the contours, the tracing there of a child's legs. And kind of slipping from the front of the lap of the woman. So here is a really startling, clear image of the murder of a Jewish family, because with the Holocaust by bullets, every bullet was a person. Although the Germans often didn't want to waste bullets on the children, and that little boy whose hand is being held fell into the pit, was brought down into the pit with the woman and the other child, and most likely died because of suffocation, because of the earth and the weight of the other victims.
This photograph it's so painful to see, and I can imagine this 10-year investigation that you undertook. I know too, Wendy, that you feel strongly that this family would not want to be remembered as they're seen in this photograph of the awful final moments of their lives. We have another photo, though, taken of them just a few months earlier. Can you tell us about it?
Well, in my investigation and going through all the different testimonies that are available, I did find that the relative of a victim in this massacre in Mirapol in October 41 did come forward. She was a child at the time of the war and was evacuated with her family, but that was her aunt over to the right, the woman in the sleeveless dress. Her name was Hiva. And after the war, this woman testified that her family was shot in that park in Mirapol, and that her aunt and her cousins, those children, were killed in the park, as well as her grandmother, actually, who's not pictured there. Now, this is the Zandler family and the Vasilyuk family, what's left of it, the women and children. This photograph was taken not too long before the one that was of the murder. And here they are looking at us, we can't see the woman's face, it's obscured in the smoke in the other photo. No family, obviously, wants to be killed in that way with their kin in that horrific way. That's the cruelty of the genocidaires, and certainly not to be humiliated by not only the killing, but the camera that the photographer took them being killed in their last moments. And so this photograph that we were just looking at is so important for affirming this is how they wanted to be viewed at the end. And indeed, it was a few months before they were killed. And that's how I want us to memorialize those victims. But the photograph that we saw before of their murder is really important for research and for reconstructing what happened, the fate of Jews in places like Ukraine and these small communities where we have so few traces of their existence, even their names. They are among the missing. So few people could come forward to actually register them as murdered.
Right. Wendy, you mentioned that locals either participated in or witnessed the massacre. And one of our audience members has a similar question about the level of collaboration from local Ukrainians. Can you tell us more so that we can understand how local people may have been lured into the Nazis' campaign to wipe out the Jews?
Yes, the photographer in the image that we looked at from Mirapol, the Slovakian photographer, Lubomir Skrovina, did testify about these photos that he took during the war in 1943 and after the war in 1958. And he mentioned in his testimony that those Ukrainian militia who were doing the shooting, they knew, here we have the picture of the photographer in the center, and that was taken also in Mirapol in the photo studio that was taken in September 1941, so about a month before he took the images of the mass murder. And he mentioned in his testimony that the Ukrainian militia were calling out some of those Jewish victims by name. They were indeed their neighbors. They were part of this small community. So not only did the Ukrainians know these victims, but there were onlookers. There were witnesses. We went back. We spoke with them. They were watching. They were listening. They could hear. They could smell. They knew exactly what was going on in their town. And what were their motives? Well, some of them were terrified and witnessed and were hiding and trying not to see and not talking about it for decades. But then there were others who were went into town as soon as the massacre started the night before and through the night and started to avail themselves of anything they could get their hands on, whether it was ransacking a Jewish shop or tearing apart Jewish homes and taking whatever they could, or even taking the women, the Jewish girls, abusing them, sexually abusing them shortly before they were actually murdered. So there were different reactions in the local population, not much in the way of documented resistance at all. I mean, some locals tried to hide Jews who fled, most of the time, those Jews were then handed over to the authorities. They were not, they couldn't find shelter for very long.
I was just going to mention longstanding anti-Semitism in the area, prejudice against Jews and as a factor. And at the same time, one of our audience members comments, this just didn't happen by itself. It was taught in churches against Jews. Few spoke up. It was going on for centuries. Can you comment more on the longstanding anti-Semitism?
Yes, it's very important to point out how entrenched this was and really how complex anti-Semitism is, how it exists in so many forms and over centuries, as your viewer mentioned. So in this case of the Nazi invasion of Operation Barbarossa, this was a attempt to wipe out not only the Jewish population, but to fight against Bolshevism, as they called it, fight against communism. So it was this political ideology that was part of the anti-Semitism of the time. And local collaborators and folks in local communities, they had just experienced a decade of terror under Stalin and associated the Jews, scapegoated and blamed the Jews for that terror, for the famine, the Holodomor, the Ukrainian famine in the 30s, the deportations, the show trials. And so a lot of the Nazi propaganda promoted this and incited this anti-Semitism, which was building on generations of anti-Judaism, of an anti-Jewish sentiment that was rooted in Christianity and Orthodox Christianity in this case. So there were various forms of kind of Jew hatred in these communities. This was, fomented and also a powerful weapon and helps us understand why ordinary people on the ground, why government officials, because it was official propaganda, whether in uniform or a local peasant, you know, who had generational memories of pogroms in the late 19th century. So, you know, it was a combination of forces that came together in a really lethal way, devastating way.
And for some of our listeners, could you expand a little bit on pogrom, what you mean by pogrom?
Pogrom is a Russian word that means riot or attack. And they, you know, they predate the 19th century, but that's when the term came into wide use. And this was, you know, local kind of popular violence that was incited and often organized or condoned by authorities. And there was sadly a kind of ritualistic tradition of this across Europe. And this was part of the Holocaust, is this history of popular violence, anti-Semitic violence, that then combined with a state-sponsored campaign that the Nazis led.
And this is what the photographer who took the photograph that you investigated saw. And if I can ask one more question about that, it seems to have been taken, that photograph seems to have been taken at very close range. Are we to understand, does that indicate somehow that the photographer was also complicit in these murders?
It's a great question, because when I first saw the photograph, and I realized just how vivid, as I said, it was vivid. It's taken openly. Again, the Holocaust by bullets is in broad daylight. It's a stable image with the family at the center. And so it seems like this person was there on, you know, officially and had the, you know, was free to take these images. The Nazis were trying to suppress these images because they knew that they could be part of the resistance once they would, you know, kind of fall into the wrong hands, into the Allies' hands. And so they issued a lot of bans to tell, you know, local officials, stop photographing these atrocities. But they could not suppress this evidence, these kinds of images. They were in circulation. And indeed, the photographer knew this, and he was part of the resistance. So to my surprise, I learned that the Lubomir Skrovina, as he was with his Slovakian unit, he was the scribe in that unit, so he was officially allowed to have a camera, and he was a hobby photographer and knew what he was doing with his Zeiss icon. So he went to that massacre that day, was told to go check it out by his superior, and went with his comrade, his Slovakian comrade. He was in uniform, pulled out his camera and took that picture, but also took others to document the process, how the Jews were forced to the edge of town and marched to town, the edge of that killing site, how they resisted. He took pictures of Jews along the path who tried to flee and were shot as they were marched to that site. And this photo was, he was 25 years old, the photographer. He didn't want to fight in this war. He started to realize that it wasn't a regular military campaign, that the Jews were being massacred. Pogroms had occurred that he also documented. And he started to write letters to his wife and explain to her that this was, that this had to stop, that he didn't want to participate in it anymore. He went back to his hometown in Banska Bystrica. He refused to go. He pretended he was sick, and at Christmas time did not go back to continue in the fight towards Stalingrad, the military campaign. And he ended up showing these photographs. There he is after the war in 1958. He was interrogated at that point as well. He showed these photographs to members of the Jewish community in his town and warned them, this is what's going to happen to you if you respond to the deportation calls and are sent east. Mm-hmm. And he brought Jews to the forest out in his town and tried to help them in 1944. Sadly, not all of them survived in the forest. But in fact, that photograph, as difficult it is to look at, as humiliating as it was for those Jews to be photographed and for that photographer to take that of them. Once we research it, we find out that that photograph was an act of resistance and was used in the resistance to actually help Jews, and that the photographer himself actually sheltered Jews.
Wendy, our audience is really relating to what you're sharing here, the content that you're sharing, and they're in turn sharing their own personal stories. Joanna mentions that her mother was shot and thrown into a ravine in Maletrostenets. She's 94 now and mourning. Mark Glickman, also former USHMM employee, said, this is how my grandfather's aunt, uncle, and cousins died in Kremnitz. 19,000 Jews were murdered in a field outside of the town over a period of 3 days. Thank you for sharing your painful family memories. But you can see how this really rings with our audience.
Yeah, there's just so much of this history that has to be uncovered. And every time a family member comes forward and shares that, it's absolutely essential that they share that information so that we can start to do that research and document their lives and establish what happened, because that's what we have to rely on. It's so important. Thank you so much for sharing that information.
And actually, with that in mind, this the larger concept of the Holocaust by bullets, the phenomena of this, how long did it take for the world to learn about it, about the Holocaust by bullets and these victims?
Decades, absolutely decades. And really, it wasn't until the collapse of the Soviet Union in 1991 that the full story started to come out. And it's still coming out, as we've just seen with your viewers who are providing more information. This picture was taken not too long after the massacres, actually, the Babi Yar massacre at the end of September 41. And it was actually taken by a member of a propaganda unit for the Germans. And there we're seeing the cover-up, the beginning of the cover-up. First, the Germans dynamited the walls of the ravine to kind of fill it in, and they covered up the victims with the dirt. You can see that they're kind of busy at work there. The Soviets came in. So the Germans did an official cover-up with a unit that was assigned to cover the traces. But then the Soviets kind of continued to do that cover-up work after the war. When they filled in the ravine, they turned it into a park. They suppressed the history by not talking about the fact that most of the victims were Jews who were shot there, although there were maybe 100,000 who were killed there, so POWs and Ukrainian nationalists. It continued to be an execution site and mass murder site during the war. But the fact that it was the bulk of the majority of the Jews were victims, the Babi Yar events that we're talking about today, that memorializing today, 80 years ago, that part of it was suppressed. And they turned it into a park. There happened to be a brick factory near this location. It was the outskirts of town, as we mentioned, but with the urbanization, the urban development of Kiev. So there was industry there. It became a kind of a toxic dumping ground. And then in 1961, there was a kind of natural disaster that was caused by these human activities, by filling in the ravine, by having a factory there that's pouring out this waste, a mudslide. The mudslide then forced the earth kind of into Kiev, into the city, and human remains were then part of that flow that went into the city. And it was just horrific for inhabitants of Kiev, residents of Kiev, to then kind of relive the, see this in 1961. Books had been written, poems had been written, but they had been censored and suppressed. On this history, the Soviets even suppressed that disaster, that natural disaster in 1961. So we don't really have a memorial culture emerging there until after the collapse of the Soviet Union. When Dina died in 77, a few years before that, a marble or granite slab was placed there to mark the site. But it was really a longer history of suppression, whether in censorship of history, filling in the actual, like physically filling in the ravine, and then actually hiding the fact that human remains had been unearthed in this natural disaster.
Jeannie from our audience has added, it's very sad that many are trying to erase history. She says this is wrong. How can we learn from it if we didn't see how horrible it was? That supports what you're saying, of course. Is there more you could tell us about other efforts to remember what's been done to remember the victims murdered at Babi Yar?
Well, there had been a menorah was placed there, again, after the Soviet Union collapsed in 1991. And then other, you know, types of memorial to the different victims who perished there. So there has been that effort. And then more recently in Kiev, centered in Kiev, coming from that community, and actually it's a bit of an international movement as well, to develop a memorial, a museum, a learning center, to reconstruct the history there using these photographs, collecting these testimonies, getting this information up online, reporting on it in a way to the greater community through the press. So in addition to these annual commemorative events, we are seeing now, finally, 80 years on, these more, you know, active approaches to finding out what happened there, acknowledging what happened there, and building the appropriate kinds of both symbolic, kind of artistic, as well as, you know, educational resources for Ukrainians, for the wider world.
Jennifer would like to say thank you for sharing. Thank you for keeping the past in the present, no matter how much it hurts or how uncomfortable it can be. We will remember these beautiful human beings and honor their memories. Thank you, Jennifer, for sharing that with us too. And Wendy, I want to thank you again for joining us today and helping to shed light on some of these less known but such vital facts about the Holocaust. As I mentioned at the start of our program, a common understanding of the Holocaust largely has not included the Holocaust by bullets. Research undertaken by Wendy and others provides a more complete picture of what really happened in the former Soviet Union and what the Nazis and their collaborators perpetrated against Jews in Eastern Europe. The devastating impact of the Nazi campaign to annihilate the Jewish population in Ukraine and other parts of the former Soviet Union resulted in the deaths of 2 million Jews, one third of all Jewish Holocaust victims. Of course, our conversation today is even more appropriate and poignant given the tragic anniversary marking 80 years since the Babi Yar massacre. We invite you to learn another aspect of this history at our next program on Wednesday, October 13th at 9:30 a.m. To commemorate Disability Awareness Month, we will discuss the Nazis' first victims of mass murder and learn about some of the medical professionals who betrayed the trust placed in them and took part in the murder of approximately 250,000 people with mental and physical disabilities. Thank you again for joining us this morning.